I'm here but for a moment. It's all I've ever known. But this world is not my home. The fight is not my own. These burdens aren't my future. The empty tomb has shown that I am bound for glory. For a glorious place where God is all in all, where he's no longer an invisible God whose presence we sense and worship, but where he's right in front of us. It's an amazing thing to hope for. It's an amazing thing to reach for, amazing thing to believe in.
Who wore the heavens as royal robes, fashioned the morning heavenly hosts. Who gave the world things were new. Oh God, it's you. It's you who fixed his heart firm upon man, knowing the cost before he began. Who gave himself when all things were new. Oh God, it's you. It's you.
Lord, all night, God of glory, there is none like you. Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Ramirez Moody, and I serve as the associate pastor of our Young Adults and Compassion Ministry. And I'm so glad that you've joined us today. Even though you're watching online, I want to invite you to check in. You can do that on this page or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We'd love to know that you're here today. That allows us to better care for you and stay connected with you. And while you're there, let us know how we could be praying for you this week. You know, Harvest, in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 7, it says, "The point is this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give what he has decided in his own heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." As a follower of Christ, I want to help you to give cheerfully to the Lord. You can do that online on this page, or you can use the QR code on the screen. You can give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, through a text, or by simply mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus. Hey, we're so glad you joined us online today. We're glad you're here. I know you've probably heard this before, but if you live in the Chicagoland area, I want to invite you to come in person to one of our campuses next Sunday. We have plenty of room. You can sit as near or as far from someone as you want. You may be asking yourself, why come in person? We would love to have the opportunity to connect with you face to face. We want to find out how we can better care for you. So it's our hope that we will see you at one of our campuses next weekend. As a church, we love lifting high the name of Jesus in worship. And we have two Sundays remaining in our outdoor worship nights. Tonight, August 22nd at Crystal Lake and Aurora campuses at 6 p.m. And next Sunday, August 29th at Chicago Cathedral, where it will take place indoors, and our North Shore campuses as well at 6 p.m. on that day. Grab your lawn chair and a blanket, maybe pack your favorite food, invite a friend, and come. Get more details at harvestnow.info. Harvest is not only a church with small groups, we are a church of small groups. Small groups are the place where you'll experience uncommon community, the place vital to growing in your relationship with Jesus. Small groups help us apply God's word to our lives. They offer community and care, and they provide accountability. If you're not walking with Christ in a small group, we want to help you connect today. Will you go to harvestnow.info and see how you can do that? With so many going back to school or already in school, we want to pray especially for you today. Teachers, thank you for investing in the next generation. Students of every age, from preschool through college, let me pray over you right now. Lord, we just thank you for the teachers that you have gifted to shepherd and teach our students. God, I just pray that you will just go before them and begin to work out any obstacles that may be there. This is their first time returning to school, some after 18 months. And so God, will you just give them peace as they go through this process? Will you give them strength and stability when they are feeling weak or discouraged? And for our Christian teachers, God, I just pray that you will use their classroom as a ministry to not only the children that you've entrusted them with, but also with their parents. Lord, I just pray that you will have your way in the lives of our teachers and our students in this next season. And we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. Let's continue to worship.
My name is Ramirez Moody, and I'm being joined today by Emma Torres. Emma, why don't you tell us how life was before you surrendered your life to Christ?
Life before I surrender my Christ, my life to Christ.
It's okay.
Sorry. I lived pretty recklessly. I didn't really understand what it fully meant to be a Christian, even though I grew up in a Christian home and I always went to church, but I never like fully pursued Christ in my life.
Yeah. So when did you decide to stop running and pursue or surrender your life mm-hmm. to Christ?
Well, I pursued my life to Christ fully after Camp Harvest because I recently rededicated my life at Camp Harvest this year.
Yeah, wow. And so what has God been doing in your life since then?
God has just been really faithful to me. He's been showing me the ways that, you know, I need to, like, practice and be more patient. And also, he's just been showing me how good he is and what his plans are and making me more willing for him to use me throughout my walk in him.
Yeah, amen, amen. Yeah, and I've seen, yeah. And I knew you before you went to camp, mm-hmm. and I've seen a significant difference. So praise the Lord for that.
Thank you.
So why would you like to be baptized today?
Because I want to publicly proclaim my faith and also be obedient to God.
All right, well, let's do it. All right. So, Emma, it is by your public profession of faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. All right, now we're being joined by Juanita Perez. And Juanita, why don't you share with us how life was for you before you surrendered your life to Christ?
Life was a mess. Life was a mess, and I was just going through a lot. Mm-hmm. I was going through a lot.
Yeah. So what were some of the things that you were dealing with in your life at that time, at that phase?
I went through a situation mm-hmm. about almost 12 years ago. And that situation put me in a position where a grand jury was responsible for making a decision for my future and my fate. Mm-hmm. It was a really tough situation to go through. Mm-hmm. Going through that situation, I just remember crying all the time and praying mm-hmm. and asking God to intervene. Make his presence known. And I'll never forget the final court date. I could hear the grand jury arguing in the room. The security had to go over there and calm them down. Mm-hmm. He came out and announced that they were about to come out. Mm-hmm. And I just remember being so filled with emotion and not knowing what to expect and thinking, am I gonna make it home to my daughter? Mm-hmm. My lawyer and his assistant turned to me and they said, you believe in God, don't you? I said, absolutely, with all my heart. Mm-hmm. And they said, God's not done with you. He's not letting you go.
Mm. Praise the Lord, yeah.
They came out, they made their decision, and I got to go home.
Yeah, amen, yeah.
And if it wasn't for God intervening at that moment, I would have never gone home to my daughter. I would have never met my husband in 2013. We would have never got married a month after we met. Mm-hmm. I would have never made him promise to marry me in church. He would have never brought me to Harvest. Mm-hmm. We would have never had our wedding here at Harvest in 2015. Mm-hmm. My 5-year-old would have never been born. My 2-year-old would have never been born. And my daughter would have never had the opportunity to attend Harvest Christian Academy.
Yeah, amen. Yeah, so sometimes in the darkest of situations, God has a way of showing up in that.
Absolutely.
And so it was at that moment.
It was at that moment I said, I'm yours.
All right.
Just take the wheel. I'm yeah. not fighting no more.
Yeah. And it's yeah, it's interesting that he used an attorney to do that. So, Juanita, why would you like to be, well, how has life been? Well, we've heard how life has been since.
It's been amazing.
Yeah, why do you want to be baptized today?
Because I want to profess my love and my faith in God publicly.
All right, well, let's do that. All right.
Thank you.
So, here, put your arm here. So, Juanita, it is through your public profession of faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Goodness. Never get tired of hearing how God finds people.
Blessed are the mourners who are crying alone.
Man, it is so good to be back with you, Harvest. We were here 7 years.
Yeah, 7 years.
And then we moved to Austin, Texas.
It was March 1st, 2020. We'd had many plans to come back a lot, and here we are.
Yeah, 4 days before quarantine hit.
Yes, it was crazy.
It's a wild year for all of us. Mm-hmm. You know, I think about this church and I think about stories. I think about how God is using every detail of our lives to make us the kind of people that he wants us to be and that really we were made to be. I think of these baptisms and just how God is going after people in every single detail of their lives, not only in the flashy moments, but in the mundane moments. I think of this church in my own life. Our lives are made up of writing songs and working on kind of sound scores for movies. And when I first came to this church, I was just a worship leader at the downtown campus and was writing these kind of story songs about different stories in the Bible. And I remember standing up here, actually, and singing this next song for the first time. And just feeling like, God, thank you for giving me a church that really loves to remember who you are through songs and through parables. And you know, there's a reason why Jesus told parables. It's because you can really say so much with so little with a story. One of my favorite parables is the prodigal son. We like to focus on the prodigal son. We like to focus on the other brother, but it's a story about the father, about who God is. I think of the woman at the well who was in the middle of her life. She'd just been going on, kind of wasn't quite working, and Jesus meets her at the place she'd been every single day for probably who knows how many years. He meets her getting water. The most basic thing that we need as human beings. He meets her right there. You know, I just want to encourage you that God is still the God who waits for you after you've gone off and had your prodigal season. He's still the God who meets you in the mundane moments of your life. And he's still the God who knows the future and knows the past. And he's bringing our whole story as a church, whether we live in Austin or Chicago or even Afghanistan. He's bringing this whole story together.
True. I made what I'm not, my relenting, ever creating, my ever chasing God. I was sick, I was washed up, wasted. Oh, but you took my bruises, and I took your spirit, my ever trading, my ever healing, my ever chasing God. Seeker, when I was in sight, Redeemer, by your blood I'm bought, and by your grace I'm made what I'm not, my unrelenting, ever creating, my ever chasing God. Chasing, my chaser ever keeping, my keeper ever giving, my ever living God, oh, my Father ever chasing, my chaser ever keeping, my keeper ever giving, my ever living God. By your grace, I'm made what I'm not. I am relenting, ever creating, my ever chasing God.
I mentioned Afghanistan a second ago. Can we pray together just for that situation over there? I'm going to call out a few things, and then I'm going to leave a moment of silence. And just, you can pray silently, you can pray out loud, but let's really lift our voice to God. He hears us. The scriptures say he is present to the brokenhearted. He is present to the oppressed. There's a lot of violence. There's a lot of suffering. And it's easy to just think, oh, that's over there. That's happening. But this is the image of God that's being marred. This is Christ's church over there. These are children. So let's pray for protection. Let's pray for the end of the violence. Let's pray for God to do what he does best. Lord Jesus, we don't know why you allow what you allow, but we trust you in it. And it is easy for us to trust because we are in a beautiful room, in a safe place of the world. But Lord, what's going on over there? Would you be present? Would you protect people from harm? God, would you provide basic needs, food, water, shelter, clothing? And Lord, for the church over there, would you comfort them in their affliction, their real affliction? Spirit of God, would you be closer to them than their own breath? Would you be closer to them than the swords and the guns that are threatening them? Would you give them endurance? Would you remind them that this world is not the end? That though every person is appointed a day to die, that death is not the end? That you are preparing a place? You are renewing the universe? There's going to be an earth, there's going to be a city, there's going to be a home. And you're going to be there. And every wound will be healed.
People.
where we know but haven't been, like a song forgotten, a place prepared beyond the end, our home in New Jerusalem, our home in New Jerusalem.
Lord God, that is our hope, that this world is not the end, that we are headed somewhere. And we will get there not because we are faithful, but because we have a Savior who is faithful. And by His grace, we're going to see Him face to face. The work is going to be complete. Lord, we lift up Your people in Afghanistan. We lift up this church. We lift up ourselves. And Lord, continue to open our hearts this morning. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. You can have a seat.
Hey, good morning, Harvest. You guys are really going to miss that bumper video, I know. And we've been watching this for months and months now because this is the last weekend in our series in Ephesians. And you know, God's been so faithful and taught us so much through it. And I hope right now you're already grabbing your Bible and turning over to Ephesians. It probably just falls right open to the book of Ephesians. But we're going to be in Ephesians 6 today, so encouraged by all that the Lord has been teaching us through His Word. And we're excited to dig into it today. You know, I'm a pretty active person. I like to move around and run around a lot and do a lot of activities. And I absolutely hate standing still. It's like one of my least favorite things. This week we took our kids to a water park, you know, and you like stand in this long line holding this massive tube in the blazing sun for like 45 minutes for a 45-second tube ride. Let's go do it again. It drives me crazy. And so if you've done that before, if you've been to Great America and you've stood in line for an hour and 45 minutes for a 15-second ride, or you've stood in traffic on 90, oh my gosh, that little thing that says similar ETA, but it takes me through a neighborhood, I can at least move, please. You know, it's the standing still that drives me crazy. If you're standing in a super long line at the grocery store and that person in front of you is paying with a check, what year is it? Check? I can't stand standing still. It drives me nuts. And yet, that's exactly what Paul is calling us to do in our text today. As he's coming to an end to this beautiful letter of Ephesians that we've learned so much about, he's giving the believers in Ephesus and us a specific message, a final message, and that is to stand firm, to stand in who you are. And when your actions match your reality, that's what it means to stand firm. Let's see it in the text, Ephesians 6, beginning in verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. And if we're going to put this text into practice, we're going to need the Lord's help. So let's pray now. Father, we are grateful that you have given us your word. We're grateful that you have instructed us through these many months, and you've grown us in what it means to stand because of the eternal portfolio that we have. And so, God, would you instruct us today? Would you be with us today? Would you keep the spiritual forces at bay in our lives so that we can glorify you and stand firm in this battle, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if we're going to stand in who we are in Jesus Christ, we need to first stand in the Lord's strength. Paul begins here by saying this strength comes from the Lord. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. He assumes that there is a battle raging for your soul and for mine, that the enemy is at work, that it's an active, challenging battle. And the things that we go through in this life as believers are not easy. And some of you have fought battles, and some of you are fighting battles right now that no person should ever have to go through. Some of you have experienced the death of a child, or a chronic illness, or a horrific abuse. Some of you have experienced financial ruin. You've lost your house. You've lost your business. Some of you have experienced the betrayal of someone close to you. And we look at the size of our battle and think, God, I can't go on. I don't have what it takes to stand in this. God, how could you allow this? How could you use this? But beloved ones, let me tell you that the size of the battle that we're going through is a proof of the size of the strength of our God. The things that you are wrestling with, when God brings us out of those, it's a display of his incredible strength. And so we stand in his strength in the midst of the battle that we're going through. There is a war going on, but it's not against those who we think it's against. Because it's easy for us to think that our battle is against my coworker, or my spouse, or my neighbor who doesn't believe what I believe, or the media, or maybe people who are on the opposite aisle politically as you are, or maybe people who follow a false religion, or all of those other commenters on Facebook. It's easy for us to think that that's who we're fighting against. We want a biblical view of marriage, and so we're fighting against the people in our world who don't have that view. But that's not what Paul says here. Who are we fighting against? We're fighting against our enemy, the schemes of the devil and the authorities, cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Oh, there is a battle going on, but it's not against who you think it is. And when we take the time and energy and fight against the people it's not against, that's when the enemy divides us. Because look at what the enemy uses. It's the schemes of the devil. It's trickery. You see, when the enemy lines up in front of you wearing red coats, holding rifles, firing at you, you kind of know what the battle is like. You know who you're against. But when the enemy hides and blends in so that you don't know who they are or where they're coming from or what they're trying to accomplish, you have a very different battle going on. So what does spiritual warfare, what does a spiritual battle look like in my life? Well, we have, and Christians have for a long time, used these three D words to talk about the enemy's strategy in attacking us as Christians. First, the enemy seeks to divide, to separate Christians, to separate marriages, to separate families, to get you on your own feeling that you're all alone and there's nobody with you. He seeks to divide, and then he seeks to deceive, to lead us to believe something that's false, to pull us away from God's word, to have us to doubt God's promises and God's faithfulness to you, to even get us to the point where you doubt the reality of what we have in Jesus Christ. It's the strategy of the enemy to divide, to deceive, and then to destroy, to make us ineffective in following Jesus Christ, to get you and I off of the mission of bringing glory to God by making disciples of all nations. That's the enemy's strategy, to divide, to deceive, and to destroy us. But we stand in the Lord's strength against it. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5 says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God and take every thought captive to obey Christ." You see, Satan is actively trying to convince you that you don't belong to Jesus Christ. You're not saved. God must be punishing you through this. God's not good. If you were, you're not worthy to be his child. God's forgotten you. God's not working in this situation. Listen, it's an ongoing battle, and it's one of the primary reasons that Paul wrote this book of Ephesians, because Satan is the father of lies. He's the accuser of the brothers and sisters. Satan would say, "You aren't saved," but Paul reminds us, Ephesians 1, 7, and 8, "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of your trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight." Our father of lies would say, "God is punishing you through what you're going through." But Ephesians 2, 4 and following says, "But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he has loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses and sins, made us alive together with Christ." You see, the enemy would say, "You aren't worthy to be a child of God." But Ephesians 2, 19 would say, "So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God." And our enemy would say, "God has forgotten you. God's not working in this situation." Ephesians 3, 20 and following, "Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power that is at work within us, to him be the glory, and in Christ Jesus throughout all the generations, forever and ever." That's what the truth of God's word has to say. And the enemy would seek to divide and to deceive and to try to destroy us by distorting the words of God. Did God really say? But we combat that against the truth of God's word, because accusation is defeated by the accuracy of God's word. So when the enemy would tell you something that's against what God's word has to say, bring yourself back to what God's word has to say. You see, we don't listen to the schemes of the devil, but we're strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. We stand in the Lord's strength, and we stand in the Lord's provision. Paul continues here in verse 13, "Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God." You see, we've been given this armor, this provision. So picture this. Paul is writing this letter from prison, and he's looking out the jail cell at the Roman guard, the Roman soldier who's standing guard over him. And as Paul is looking at this armor that he's wearing, Paul is reminded of the spiritual battle that we're in. He's reminded of each piece of the armor that makes up the whole armor of God, so that we can stand firm in the battle that's against us. And he says to withstand, to stand firm, to stand your ground. He's not even talking about taking ground. He's not talking about attacking the enemy. He's talking about plant your feet and don't move. That's what Paul is charging us to do, to stand. This is the goal of our struggle, not to move or to waver or to falter in the midst of a difficult battle, but to stand firm. And we notice that each of these pieces, it's far more defensive than offensive. We're not told to advance, but to hold our ground. Now, standing assumes that there is a battle going on, and we need to be ready for it. Standing shows readiness, alertness. It's stay awake, be sober. He says that you may be able to stand. What Paul is saying here is that it is possible for you to stand firm in this battle that's going on. With God's strength and God's provision, you can stand. Now, I know how it feels to be in the midst of a trial and think, I don't got it. I can't anymore. I'm at the end of me. Right. And that is why you need the Lord's strength and the Lord's provision to stand firm when everything in you wants to crumble. And he tells us that each of these pieces, he reiterates the fact that take up the whole armor of God. And so while the individual pieces are really interesting to study and to look at and to wrestle with, and you know, there's like VBS lessons and all sorts of things like that that are really cool on what is the righteousness of God and all of those. But the thrust, really what Paul is going for here, is to let us know that the point is the whole armor of God. You need all of this together, working together to be able to stand. He tells us about the belt of truth, this truth that's to be all around us, and this breastplate of righteousness, that it's Jesus Christ's righteousness that's given to me and to you because of what he's done. If we turn from our sins and embrace Jesus Christ by faith, we're putting on the breastplate of his righteousness. It's protecting us through what Jesus has done. And then we're told the shoes that are on our feet, given by the readiness, given by the gospel of peace, that we're to have this solid base, this solid footing. If you've ever played sports, you know that there's a saying like, oh, you got caught on your heels. It means you were kind of leaning back when the ball came. Instead, it's a readiness for what's going to happen. We just played a softball game with our cathedral team the other day, and it's really important to be on your toes and be ready for when the ball comes. And that's what Paul is talking here, this readiness. And because we recognize that the gospel is ultimately the only thing that can and does bring peace, it's the thing that gives us security. That's why he says that it's the readiness of the peace that comes from the gospel. And any soldier will tell you that they want two things. First, they want victory. And then second, they want peace. And a soldier in the midst of the battle is looking forward to those things. And Paul is telling us, in the midst of the battle, your footing, the readiness that you have because of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that brings peace. It brings security to you and to me in the midst of the battle. No matter how the battle rages, you're secure because of what Jesus Christ did for you and for me on the cross. That's our reality. He tells us to take up the shield of faith, and this image is of the enemy shooting flaming arrows at the believer. And the shield of faith, our faith in the faithfulness of God, is the peace that helps us extinguish the attacks of the enemy and to be victorious over it. We're told to take up the helmet of salvation. It's a symbol of victorious salvation that's found in Jesus Christ, because he has already won the victory. A really cool parallel passage is in Isaiah 59:17. You can look it up sometime this week on your own. Isaiah 59:17, where he's talking about the Messiah, Jesus. And he says, Jesus put on righteousness as a breastplate and a helmet of salvation on his head. And so Paul, as he's looking at this Roman guard and thinking about all of these, the whole armor of God that we put on, he's reminded of the book of Isaiah, these promises that were given, that the Messiah would come with righteousness and with victorious salvation. And now because of what Jesus has done, we put on that same armor because we have the victory of what our Messiah accomplished. And then he says the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, this is the only piece of the whole armor that's not defensive. And it's really interesting that when Jesus was tempted by the enemy right after his baptism at the beginning of his ministry, what did Jesus do to attack back, to defend himself? He quoted God's word. Satan kept saying, well, what about this? And you just go up on this mountain and throw yourself down and people will worship you and it'll be great and you should do that. And Jesus right away came right back to God's word. You should worship God alone because that's our offensive in the battle against the enemy. When we're trying to stand firm, go back to God's word. You know, when I kept thinking about this armor of God this week, I kept thinking about Iron Man, which maybe is like a nerdy thing to bring up in church. I don't know, sorry. But I kept thinking, because he does this like press conference in the first thing, and he's like, I am Iron Man. But like, I mean, is he really until he puts the suit on? He says he is. But because it's his reality, I created the thing, all of it is part of me. But he becomes Iron Man when he takes the suit and puts it on. And that's what we're called to do here, to put on truth and righteousness and the gospel of peace and faith and salvation and the word of God. Listen, what he's saying is you already have it. You're standing firm in all of these things. And so put it on. Act like it. Live like it. Because my standing in Christ leads me to my actions for Christ. And so that's what we do. We put it on because it's already been done for us. Stand in who you already are in Jesus Christ. When I'm on an airplane, I get to take on all of the attributes of that airplane. I get to fly. Now, can I really fly on my own? Of course not. But I'm taking on all of the attributes of that plane so that now I'm flying. And that's what we're doing here when we take on the whole armor of God. We're putting on all that Jesus Christ is and has made you to be, and we're living like it. On my own, I am not able, you are not able to stand firm in the battle that rages around us. But as we put on this armor of God, as we stand in the Lord's power, as we stand in the Lord's provision, we're able to stand in the midst of a battle. And I know what it feels like to think like, I can't go on, I don't have enough to go on, but this armor is what the Lord gives us to be able to stand firm in all of it, because he is enough, and he has provided what you and I need to stand in the strength of his might. 2 Peter 1 verse 3 says, his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. He has given you everything you need to be able to stand firm in the midst of the battle. So stand in the Lord's power and stand in the Lord's provision, and then stand with constant prayer. He continues in verse 18, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints and also for me, that words may be given to me in the opening of my mouth, boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. You see, Paul links these things closely. You can't just put on the armor. You can't just rely on God's strength. You need constant prayer in order to stand in who you are. How would you ever expect to stand firm in the battle that's going on around you if you're not talking to the one who holds all of it in his hands? Psalm 127:1 says, "Unless the Lord builds the house, those who labor do so in vain." So any amount of standing, of trying on your own strength to, "I'm going to make it this week. I'm going to get past this trial. I'm going to do it." None of it will matter if you're not going to the Lord constantly in prayer and seeking his strength. And many of you are not able to stand firm in the midst of the trial that you're going through right now because you're not continually going to the Lord in prayer. And, oh, we would stand there and say, "Oh, I know prayer is important. It's one of our pillars. I mean, of course, it's important. And, yeah, I pray." But then we don't actually take the time to get on our knees. We don't actually take the time to pull out a list. We don't actually take the time to cry out until your voice is hoarse for our Lord to work in the midst of the battle that's going on. And we would say, "Well, I get busy and I just forget, and God knows my heart, and I'll do it next week." Or, I tried. Every day the last week I spent 4 minutes praying, and the Lord didn't answer. Listen, he says over and over, all prayer, pray at all times. Keep alert with all perseverance. He's telling you continually, don't give up. It's the persistent widow who comes before the Lord. All, over and over. It's really interesting. You know, here's a little freebie. Like in relationships, don't ever say always or never. It's just a bad plan. You always do this. You never take me anywhere. It's just bad. But when you're talking about prayer, I think we could take what Paul says to heart. He says, praying at all times, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. I think he's trying to tell you and I that all is pretty important. Continue in it. And he says here to pray for yourself, to bring your requests to the Lord constantly. When was the last time that your knees hurt, that your throat was hoarse, and your face was wet with the tears from your crying out to the Lord? Because that's what Paul is telling us to do. He's not telling you, like, in your car, turn the radio down for a couple seconds and pray for that meeting that you have today. He's telling you to get on your knees all. Cry out with everything that you have. When was the last time that you did that? Because this should be a regular occurrence for you and me, Christian. This should be something that we're continuing to come back to. If you got to put a reminder on your phone, if you got to put it on your calendar, if you got to put a post-it note on the mirror in your bathroom, whatever you need to do, but make this a priority to at all times be coming before the Lord. He says that we should be praying for ourselves, bringing your requests before the Lord with all prayer and supplication. So pray for yourself, but also prayer for other believers, your brothers and sisters. I love that we're doing that as a part of our services, that we're doing that together. You should be in a small group where you're actively praying for your sisters and brothers on a regular basis. I have a note on my phone that is, I have a daily prayer, things that I'm praying for every day, and then I just titled it Weekly Plus. I want to do it every couple days. These are specific things, because we're not the type of church who says, "Oh, I'll pray for you," which essentially means I'm sending you good thoughts. Forget that. That's not who we are, and it does nothing. It accomplishes nothing. Prayer to our Heavenly Father who holds it all does accomplish something. Listen, I don't have anything that I can give, really, to my brothers and sisters in my small group, to the people that I love and care for. Me just thinking about them does nothing. But me talking to the Lord about them and crying out that God would do something, that he would act, that he would give them the strength to stand firm, that's when things are accomplished. That's when things happen. We're not a, "Sure, I'll pray for you" church. We're a, "Okay, let's pray right now." That's the type of church we are. And I love it when I see in all of our buildings, all of our campuses, people in the lobby or up front or out in the parking lot with their arm on someone's shoulder, I'm praying for you right now. That's who we want to be, brothers and sisters, because our Heavenly Father holds it all. He is the one that's able to make you and I stand firm in the midst of any trial that you would have. And it only happens when we go to the Lord in constant prayer. So we pray for ourselves, we pray for all, for other believers. And then he says, make supplication for all the saints. This is a super interesting point, because we are all in a battle with one another, but not against one another. We're alongside other believers. And there is an enemy that's sending flaming darts at us. And trust me, it's not the church down the street. We do have an enemy, and we're to pray for those in our neighborhoods and around our country and across the world who are seeking to serve Jesus Christ. And they may not go to the same church as you. They might not even be in the same camp as us at times, but they're our brothers and sisters, and they're at work for the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul is calling us, and I am calling us, to pray for those people. Supplication for all of the saints who are serving the Lord Jesus. There are Bible-believing, gospel-preaching, Jesus-loving churches all over the place, and you should be praying for them. There's one a mile from every one of our campuses, and we're praying for those churches to have a gospel impact in this world, because the world needs Jesus Christ. Listen, the world doesn't need us. Truthfully, it doesn't even need our church. It needs Jesus. And we exist to make him known to a world that desperately needs him. We exist to make disciples of all nations. And it doesn't just happen with us. And so we're praying for all of the saints together. And then Paul ends by saying a prayer for him, for words given to him to preach with boldness. You know, it's so interesting where there's so much persecution that happens in the world even today. And as we've read and you've seen on social media and heard in the news, some of the Christians right now who are giving their life because they follow Jesus Christ. And that persecution is happening all across the world. And we should continue to pray for those brothers. But here is so interesting to me. Paul is in prison. He says, I'm an ambassador in chains. And he doesn't ask for provision in it. He doesn't ask to be set free. He doesn't even ask for better food, which is probably what I would ask for. He asks for boldness. If you're praying for me, the thing I want you to pray for is that I would have boldness, that I would declare the gospel as I ought to speak. Just like Peter and John in the book of Acts, they said, we can't but speak about what we've seen and what we've heard. And Paul is saying, like, I have to talk about it. I have to say it. I have to tell people about Jesus. And regardless of what storm I'm in, regardless of what jail cell the enemy has put me in, pray for boldness to speak the gospel. That is standing firm. And that's what he's calling us to. And so if the church hopes to stand in the midst of the battle that see ourselves in, it's going to happen by standing in the Lord's strength. It's going to happen by standing in the Lord's provision. And it's going to happen by standing in constant prayer. Let's hold our ground together, sisters. Let's stand together, brothers. Now, why does Paul repeat stand so much as we come to a close here? Because Paul mentions it four times throughout this short passage. Stand, stand, withstand. Why does Paul focus so much on standing? I think it's because so much damage is done when we retreat. That the damage that's done by not standing in the midst of a trial is devastating. And so Paul calls us to do that. So when you want to cut a corner to get ahead at your job, or when you're tempted to run from your marriage or your family because it's difficult, when you want to cut ties with a friend because of conflict that you have, when you feel like quitting everything and just walking away, and when it hurts to hope that the future will be any different, stand in who you are. Stand because of what God has already accomplished in you. Stand in his power and in his provision and in constant prayer. Galatians 6:9 would say, as Paul closes another one of his letters, "And let us not grow weary in doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up." We stand in who we are. Let's pray. Father, we pray for strength right now. God, you tell us to come to you, to call to you, and you will answer and show us great and mighty things that we have not known. And so, God, we pray that you would answer that prayer. God, we pray that you would give your strength to your people in our church, your people in churches across this nation who right now are gathered to worship and to make disciples and to stir one another up. God, we pray that you would give strength to stand to your people across the world who are going through difficult trials even right now. God, for the one who's in one of our worship centers or watching online and going through a difficult battle right now, God, I pray that your peace would be with them. I pray that your comfort in knowing that they can stand because of your power at work in them, I pray that that would fall on them right now. God, that they would feel your presence in their lives. God, I pray for the one who's feeling like this battle will never come to an end. God, how much longer do I have to stand in this same spot with seemingly no advancement? God, would you be their strength? Would you be their provision? God, I pray for the one who has been praying constantly, who has spent the time on their knees and the time crying out to you. God, the one who feels like an answer will never come, the end of this battle will never come. God, would you be their strength through it? Would you bring a light at the end of the tunnel? Would you work even this week? Would you declare yourself strong in their life? God, maybe you won't bring them out of the battle this week, but would you turn the tide? Would you display to them that you're at work even now, even in the darkest valley, in the hardest battle? And God, we pray for all of the saints, for the Bible-believing Christians in this land and across the globe who are serving you. Would you be their strength? Would you work in them? Would you take the efforts of their hands and put them to good use as they plant seeds each and every day? Lord, would you help us to reap a harvest of righteousness that's found in you? And God, for each of us, would you give us the boldness to speak for Jesus Christ? Would you give us the boldness to stand in the midst of a battle and a trial that continues to go on? You are faithful and you are strong over it all. We've seen you work in the past, and although we haven't gone through this before, we've seen you deliver us from that before, and so we trust you in the midst of it. So God, would you show yourself strong? Would you give us the strength to stand in who we are for your glory and your purposes? Would you allow us to reap as we don't give up in this battle for Jesus Christ? Help us to hold our ground. When we feel like we can't go on, we pray that you would be our strength through it all. We pray in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
That's the book of Ephesians. How good to be in God's Word together. We want to invite you back next Sunday morning at 9 and 11 a.m. Central Time. And if you're ready and you live in the Chicagoland area, we'd love to see you in person next Sunday. And Harvest, remember, you are loved.